you ask not. And I know that a couple Sundays ago, I'm not up to speed, I got to get Sunday's message, I heard it was blind blowing. So everybody that wasn't here Sunday, make sure you get a DVD or a CD of the message. I'm looking forward to it. Tammy's giving it two thumbs up.
Yep.
But I did read the scriptures that were in the references. So the Lord wants us to know when to ask and when to speak. Mm-hmm. Because there's times when we don't have to ask. You know, we talked about that a couple weeks ago. There's times when we don't have to ask, is it the Lord's will or what to do in the situation. There's times we just need to speak and believe and know that it will come to pass. And I was thinking a lot, I read the passage from Galatians. We are heirs.
Yes.
We are heirs.
Yes.
We are princes and princesses.
Yes.
We have authority.
Yes, we do.
In the name of Jesus Christ. And so, does a prince ask for the keys to the kingdom?
No.
No. Does a prince ask for what he wants? No, he tells.
Yes.
He speaks, and it happens.
Yes. Yep.
We have ministering angels. We have power over the earth that we were given dominion over. We have the authority to speak to things and expect for them to change. And I guess when we're praying, we need to ask for wisdom to know the difference. We need to pray to stir up the gifts within us. We need to pray to lower ourselves into the presence of Jesus Christ. You know, when we fight through all of the distractions, when we fight through the multitudes, right? In Luke, it was the multitudes. And it was, they were going to get into the presence of the Lord because that was where the answer is. That is always where the answer is.
Yes.
The answer is always in the presence of the Lord. And we need to do whatever we need to do to get ourselves in the presence of the Lord.
Right.
And the answer is right there,
right,
waiting.
Amen.
So I encourage you, no matter what is going on, no matter what the need is, no matter what, there's something else. So how many times do I catch myself saying, I wish I had, or I wish this was. I'm done wishing. I caught myself doing that this morning. Gosh, I just wish I had 3 more hours in the day. I wish I had just a little bit more time. There's always more time. The Lord says, stop wishing. And speak and make the most of what I already have given you.
Yes.
He has given us more than enough time.
Yes.
He has given us more than enough money. He has given us more than enough health. He has given us more than enough dominion and authority to do what we need to do and what we are called to do.
Yes.
Stop wishing. Right. Stop asking when we should be speaking.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, that is so empowering.
Yes.
You know, we have been told for years now who we are.
Yes.
It's time to let that be birthed in us and walk in the fullness of who we are. We are fully convinced.
Yes.
We are one.
Yes.
We are one. There is no difference between me and the body of Jesus Christ.
Right.
We are one.
That's a yes.
We are one.
Yes.
We have all of the authority. Now,
yes.
Do I have it in myself? No, I have it, but it's not me who lives.
Amen.
It's Christ who liveth in me.
Right.
And the power of his resurrection lives in me.
Right.
But do I loose it?
That's
we
it.
Have to loose it. It is in heaven. Our Lord is in heaven waiting and watching for us to be the power and the authority of heaven on earth.
Lord.
It is us. We are the gatekeepers of the kingdom of God, of heaven itself.
Yes.
It is up to us to open our mouths and to speak heaven into earth.
Yes.
We are to speak the kingdom of God and watch.
Yes.
And just watch
as
his presence is manifest. When we gather together, his presence manifests.
Yes.
And when he is in the midst, everything's taken care of.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Any testimonies or prayer requests? Yeah, Jody.
I just want to apologize. The last few weeks, we've been out softball.
You should.
We're still hearing from y'all. It's so long.
You were better.
But what you're saying, I just want to read to you some words he gave me. And it's been a couple weeks ago, but it's funny how it all just, God is on time.
Yeah.
So he said this to me. He said, the kingdom is here. We are in the kingdom. The world was created. get up each morning with a song to sing, and they just live knowing, I will provide. Gosh, sorry, this phone. Technology. How much more are we to God than the birds of the air?
Right.
Before the fall, God told Adam he had dominion in the land. So I looked up the word dominion,
mm-hmm.
and it says sovereignty and control.
Yeah.
And sovereignty means supreme power or authority. So we have supreme power,
yes.
like you were saying,
yeah.
and authority in this land right now.
Yes.
Right.
He gave Adam the dominion in the land to name the things, to claim the things, to eat freely of the food. Abundance was Adam's. Now we have a greater abundance because of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Yes.
Don't be stifled. Just as Adam named and claimed things, so are we to do as kingdom beings. We are in the kingdom. We just need to believe it, walk in it, claim it in the name of Jesus. So I just think that that is what he's trying to tell us. You
yeah.
know?
Yes.
This is what you have. There is nothing more to come to you.
Yeah.
We are in the kingdom.
That's
yes.
right.
Just need to claim it, believe it. There are things coming against everybody.
Yeah.
And it's like we've got to look through that and pass that
yes.
and just know we are who God says we are.
Yeah.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, Mike.
Pray for Roberto. He heard attack at the gym this morning, so
okay.
pray for his healing.
Yes.
Yep.
Amen.
Part of God's been dealing with me for months, and I've been trying to pull it together so that it makes sense. But just a highlight. He told us to be good stewards.
Mm-hmm.
That's not just money.
Right.
We have the kingdom. We are
right.
to steward that kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
We are to steward the favor. We are to steward
yeah.
the grace. And just like with the talents, if we have it, that's great. But if we bury it and don't do anything with
mm-hmm.
it,
Whoa.
It doesn't do anything.
Right.
So a good steward
right.
takes mm-hmm. it and multiplies it.
Right.
And the only way we can multiply it is by speaking it.
Yeah.
That's
yes.
right.
Amen.
Amen.
And sharing it. Yeah, amen.
Great
job. Amen. Anyone else? James. So I go to the Lord in prayer tonight.
Yes.
Heavenly Father,
Father
we thank you.
We
thank
you,
Lord. That you are more than enough. But you have already placed in us more than enough, God, to speak to every situation,
every
circumstance. We thank you, Lord. We invite you in this house tonight, Lord. We come and join together, Lord, to worship you. To hear your word be transformed by it, to lift you up and worship you together. We thank you, Lord, that you give us wisdom to know when to ask and to know when to speak, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us the words. If we just simply open our mouths, Lord, trusting that the words will be there for each situation, Lord. We are called to be salt and light, Lord. Let our light shine, bringing glory to you, Lord. And let the savor of life be found in the words from our lips, Lord. Glory
yes,
to you.
Yes, Lord.
Be with us tonight, Lord. Be with us tonight,
Lord.
As we worship you, Lord. As we lift you up, Lord. As we gather
yes,
together,
Lord.
To be transformed,
yes,
Lord, by the hearing of your word, Lord. Let your spirit move. Let your ministering
yes,
spirits move in this place, Lord. Encourage those, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Encourage those that need their head lifted high, Lord. gave us revelation about the redeemed man that you have created, the new creation. Lord, as the hunger spreads across this nation, Lord, let it come in this house. Stir up our hearts, Lord. Let us stir up the gifts, Lord. Let us dig deeply and stir up the gifts within our hearts, Lord. That your kingdom will come, Lord. As we speak, the mountains shall be removed, Lord, and cast into the sea. As we speak, let Zion fall. Let it come and let us go up to the mountain and rejoice. Let us spread our wings and mount up like eagles as you renew our youth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You make all things new, Lord. You make all things new, and tonight make us new. Make us new. Do a new work in our hearts. Do a new work in our minds, Lord. Let wisdom and revelation come. Let us be transformed, Lord. May be fully formed in each and every member of this body. Fully formed, mature. Bringing the kingdom. Bringing the kingdom of heaven wherever we go. Let us open the gates of our mouth and loose. Loose hope. Loose love. Loose grace. Yes, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this place of worship. This house of thank you that when we come, we are fed. We thank you that when we come, you are in our midst, Lord. We thank you that when we come together, something so special happens in this house, in this body, Lord. We thank you that you have called us to be members of this body, but there are those who are missing, Lord. There are those who are not hearing the call. There are those who are ignoring the call. There are those who need ears to hear. As you draw them in, let this body be fully formed. Let this body, abundant life, be fully formed to function in the fullness that you created this house to function. Let all those who have been hurt by religion, let all those who have been hurt by relationships, let those hurts be healed and let their ears and their hearts be open to seek after you. Jesus. Bind up the brokenhearted, Lord, who are afraid. Who are afraid. Those who are confused. Those who don't know where to turn. Seeking truth but not seeing the truth for the simple message that it is. A free gift of grace. So easily missed, so easily made into something that it's not. But the power of salvation is in the simplicity of the grace, the free gift of grace. Let us offer the free gift of grace to all those we meet, Lord. Let us freely give that which we have received in abundance. Let the grace, the simplicity, the power of your grace flow from this house into this city, into the lives of all those around us. And your kingdom come, Lord. Your kingdom come, Lord. Renew our minds tonight. Renew our minds, Lord. Renew our hearts and our hope, Lord. To trust in you, to believe for more, Lord. There's always more, Lord. There's always more, Lord. Let us hunger and thirst for more. Shall be filled. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that the answer is always yes and amen. Yes and amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just a reminder to check your cell phones, make sure they're off. And this Friday night, Tom Stamen, 7 p.m.
Amen.
Be here or be square.
Are we over there?
Saturday morning.
Are we locked in, Pastor?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I haven't talked to anybody, but I mean, so we're on, I guess, as far as
okay. Do I need to call Brandon or for the crane?
Yeah, I suppose I could have checked. Toby. Andy.
Andy.
Said that he had available. I know you were talking about it before, too, and I didn't want to give it to you. You guys.
I should see him in the morning.
Okay. doesn't work this Saturday, then we'll back it up a week. Because I'm going to load it up tomorrow night in my truck, and I'd rather not be in there a week. So if I can know why tomorrow night, that'd be great.
You don't want to drive around with that, do
you? I can't. I won't. No, I won't drive it.
All right, let's speak. Let's pray for wisdom in that.
Yes. This works out.
I'll have to lean it over to Cap because it's 12 foot tall. It'd be 15 feet tall.
Yeah, that might work.
You did all the bridges on the way here.
You just need some sparklers and some flyers and get some of the banners going on.
That's part. Yeah. And I'm not going to leave it over here by itself.
Yeah.
Good idea.
All right, let's speak the word tonight.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah. Thank the Lord.
Toby, can I ask you to come take the offering tonight, please?
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. How great is your goodness, how great is your kindness, how great is your mercy to me, how great are your wonders, how great is your power, how great is your favor to me, and I'll sing of all your goodness, all your loving kindness, I celebrate your faithfulness to me. I'll celebrate your name. I'll celebrate your name.
You are faithful.
Cause you are faithful, God. And you will never change. And I will celebrate your name. Celebrate your name.
Cause you are faithful.
Cause you are faithful, God. And you will never change. And I will celebrate your name. I'll celebrate your name. And I'll sing of all your goodness, all your loving kindness. Celebrate your faithfulness to me. Now live here in your presence, live to give you reverence. Celebrate your faithfulness to me. How great is your goodness, how great is your kindness, how great is your mercy to me.
In heaven.
quickly. Your will be done the same on earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven come to earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven come. 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 Because yours is the kingdom, yours is the power, yours is the glory.
Yours is the power.
The kingdom is here, God.
Yours is the kingdom, Lord.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Your kingdom come.
Yours.
Jesus.
It is now. The citizens of heaven arise.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Your so
low.
Oh, yours is the kingdom, Lord. Yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Yours is the power and the kingdom and the glory. See your face of my brothers and sisters, Lord. I want to see your face, Lord, as those who love you, Lord, release your kingdom, Lord. Yes. We were created in your image, yes. Lord. Yes. We have your face, yes. Oh Lord. Let it not be on the inside anymore, Lord. Let the world cry out. We want to see the face of the Lord. Let them cry, show me your face, Lord. Show me your face. Give my brother strength, Lord. The ungird of my legs, that I might stand in this holy place. Oh, Lord, show me your face, Lord. Your power. I can make it through the end if I could just see your face. Moses stood on a mountain waiting for you to pass by. Put your hand over his face, so in your presence he wouldn't die. And all of Israel saw the glory as it shines out through the age. Now you call me boldly to release Stands on the mountain, waiting for you to pass by. They need to see you all over our face, that America would not die. Glory. Call me boldly to release your grace.
Show me your face, Lord. Show me your face.
I gird up my legs, that I might stand in this holy place.
Show me your face, Lord, your power and grace.
I can make it. If I could just see your face. The bride knows there's something more than the past of your presence.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
In this day, something new is born.
Yes, Lord.
Among the kings and the presence.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, show us all your glory.
Let it shine down through the age.
Now you call me boldly. Your grace.
Show me your face, Lord.
Show me your grace.
Show me your grace.
Bend good up my legs, that I might stand in this holy.
Jesus. We love you, Lord. We bless your name tonight. Father, we thank you for the power that you've invested in us.
Yes, Lord.
For your faithfulness, for your confidence, Lord.
Yes.
To give such power and such authority,
yes, Lord,
to human beings. The Lord, has been your plan from the beginning,
yes,
to be one with your creation.
Mm-hmm.
And for your creation to reflect you. And Lord, we know that that is what the great awakening is all about.
Yes.
It's the awakening of the bride. It's the awakening,
yes,
of Christ in us,
yes,
the hope of glory.
Hallelujah.
We celebrate that tonight, Lord. We declare it to be our reality,
yes,
the reality of the kingdom,
yes, Lord,
the reality of the mysteries of Christ.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name, praise the Lord. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all for being here. Thank you, worship team. That was great tonight. It's always good. Amen. Holy Spirit's always anointed. And it is good in Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. And I'm gonna be as brief as possible tonight, praise the Lord, and still say what I need to say. I appreciate the testimonies, as always. It's amazing how God, as Jody was saying, speaks on, my pastor used to always say God speaks on both ends, you know, so it's never a one-way thing. It's always like it comes together somehow. And because we all have the same spirit, obviously, the Lord does speak to us in the same way. Praise God. So I want to start I'm going to stay in Ephesians. I don't know that I'm even going to get out of there, but we'll just begin with Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 19. Praise the Lord. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power? And of course, we refer back to this particular scripture all the time, because it is kind of the basis, I believe anyway, for this church. And I think y'all pretty much understand that. We all kind of come to that same place, you know. And so those scriptures are especially powerful, as far as I'm concerned, because I believe they speak prophetically to what God's doing in this church and what he will continue to do. So he says here that, what is the exceeding greatness? And we just, you know, if I were to go back and just let me, verse 8, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance is in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of power to usward. Now, he just talked about this thing that's going on in the saints, this revelation, this understanding and awakening, whatever you want to call it. And the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. So, in a sense, that just tells you it's grace, grace, you know, grace for grace. You know, it's just it's his power given to us by his power. You know, it's kind of the way it works, praise the Lord. But what got my attention is it's to usward who believe. Now, the basic idea of belief has a twofold meaning. And I think it's really significant. We talked about it some last Sunday. We talk about it all the time, really, because we kind of use faith and belief, or believing and faith, as synonyms or words that basically are telling us the same thing. And so there are two Anglo-Saxon words, these are old English words, amen, that actually make up the word believe. And the first one, of course, is be, which is simply to live or to exist. And the second is lifan, And that means in accordance. How many of you know we've got to live in agreement with God, with what God says, with what God has declared? And that's what really the essence of what believing is. It's existing in agreement with God, which is basically what we talked about last Sunday. It's about wake up. I mean, realize, well, if he said it, it's true. It's got to be true. So we've got to live. We've got to exist in agreement with that truth. Otherwise, we're just kind of scattered all the time. Sometimes we hit it, and other times we just miss it, you know. So to believe literally means to live in accordance, in our case, with God. But actually, in general terms, it means to believe or to live in accordance with anything, whatever it might be. But we're accustomed to think belief is something that's simply mental, you know, acquiescence with some particular truth. So, you know, like 2 plus 2 is 4, so we believe 2 plus 2 is 4. So it's like just a mental acceptance of a truth that is out there, amen? But its roots lead us to action. Because what the mind accepts, the will obeys. That's just the, you know, the most basic idea of thinking. We do all sorts of stuff, and we think we don't think about it. But the truth is, you can't do anything without thinking about it. You can't do anything unless you have already thought it and believe that that's the course that's going to take place. It just happens so in a nanosecond. It just happens so fast that it doesn't all register in our conscious mind. So this is kind of the way that God is developing us. We are new creatures in Christ. We have the mind of Christ. And so God is doing things that we shouldn't really have to think about, which is what we were talking about tonight. We ought to just act. We ought to just speak out and declare and move, because this reality, this believing, is active. It isn't passive. It isn't something, well, yeah, I believe. No, you believe, there's a response. They're going to do something based on what you believe. Amen? So let's go to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you're saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I want to read that again, because we read these things and don't really think about what it is we're reading sometimes. Even when we were dead in sins, he quickened us. He made us alive in Christ by grace. Not by anything we did, but just because we accepted it, right? And has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, do you believe that? I mean, do we live according to that? In accordance with that? Do we live with the idea that that's the reality? That's my reality, right? Amen? To manifest the consciousness of that, there has to be a daily acceptance of the fact. That's why you got to have your mind renewed. That's why we got to walk in the Word. That's why and I'm not talking about memorizing. I'm talking about we know enough. We don't need to really memorize any more scriptures. That'd be good. There's nothing wrong with it. But I'm saying we know the truth. What we have to do is constantly remind ourselves, constantly keep our mind renewed to this reality so that it can manifest. Because action happens as a result of what we think, what we believe, what we are thinking in accordance with, or what we are agreeing with. Amen? Yes. So you see what I mean?
Yes.
Seated far above all the powers of the air, and not just are we seated above all of them, but as it was already said this evening, they are subject to us.
Yes.
Amen. To believe that, when we believe it, when we actually begin to live in agreement with that, in accordance with that reality, forces will yield obedience. That's how sick people get healed. That's how doors are open. That's how prosperity comes. That's how, you know, the dead are raised. That's how people get saved. Amen. So They yield to the obedience. Obedience to us. Amen. And when that happens, it manifests spiritual authority in the natural realm. It's what Jesus did every day of of his ministry. He simply walked in agreement with who he was, who he understood himself to be. Remember what he, in Mark, where he talks about, he said, he opened the scripture to Isaiah and he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He found himself right there. Yeah. Now, it wasn't like that was the first time, but he was showing everybody, hey, I know who I am. But it wasn't just for the people that were there. It wasn't so much for them as it was he was declaring again. He had just come out of the desert with this argument with the devil about who he was, what his true identity was. And he just carries it a step further and walks right into the synagogue and says basically the same thing. Because he has anointed me to preach the good news, the gospel, to set captives free. Amen. We've got the same mandate. We have the same call of God on our lives as the body of Christ. Amen. And so, praise the Lord. When that begins to happen, it'll surprise you. You ever pray for somebody and they're healed instantaneously? It's a shock. Now, I got to tell you, even when you believe that that's the reality, that's what should happen. When somebody has been declared dead, you pray for them and all of a sudden they're alive again, it'll blow your mind. It'll freak you out. Because we're not used to it. But it didn't freak Jesus out because he was totally used to it. He was in total agreement. He believed in what God said about who he was and what power he had. Praise the Lord. The forces that we contend with, principalities and powers, world rulers of darkness, hosts of wickedness, wicked spirits and heavenlies, let me promise you something. They know us better than we know us. They're just scared to death that we'll learn what they already know. That we'll begin to act out of what they're already afraid of. Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Heavenly places. That's the place of the most intense conflict. Nothing gets done here unless it's done there first. That's why he seated us there rather than just keeping us here. We are seated in heavenly places because that's where our authority comes from. Amen? That's where the greatest conflict, we think it's here because the flesh is what's always dealing with it, but the truth is none of this stuff happens if it hasn't already happened there. Amen? The word is settled there. Amen? It's just that the enemy tries to twist it so that by time it's here, it's no longer settled. Now it's a kind of a coin toss. Coin toss. Or coin toss, depending on whether you're dyslexic. Praise the Lord. But the place of the most intense conflict is the heavenlies. Amen? The believer, all of us, when our eyes have been opened to comprehend what he talks about here, that they might know, right? When we have comprehension of our throne rights, exactly what Suzanne was talking about. We have throne rights that come directly from the throne. Nothing can come between us and whatever we say or speak from that position. Recognizing that we are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that if all the heavenlies are subject to us, then there's nothing on this earth that we got to worry about because they're all subject to the heavenlies. Amen? That's why when Daniel prayed, you know, the angel came and he said, hey, I'd have been here sooner, but there was a big battle going on because the prince of Persia tried to keep me from getting here with the word from God. To settle it here, amen, as you prayed it. That's the battle. Well, now we, unlike Daniel, have been elevated and seated now in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, where we just speak the word. We don't have to wait for an angel to come to validate it. We already have more than enough validation if we just stand on it. If we just declare it. Praise the Lord. Because here's the deal. The real threat that we have is the same threat that Jesus had on earth. And that is total control over demonic forces. Sin, sickness, disease, poverty, that's all a part of demonic activity. It doesn't come from God. It isn't God, you know, saying, well, I'm going to put you through this to test you somehow or to try, you know, find out if you're, you know, ready for it. That's all bogus. The enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Everything negative is coming from demonic spiritual forces. Jesus confronted them constantly, and they were all subject to him. Amen. Even when he was here on earth. Now he has been elevated. Amen. And he has this name which is above every name, that every knee has to bow to him. Every knee, whatever it is, it has to bow to him. You say, well, cancer doesn't have a knee. Yeah, it does. Sickness has a personality behind it. There is a demonic spirit behind sickness. Amen. And that individual, that thing, has to have a physical, you know, a spiritual body that has to kneel, has to yield, amen, to the name of Christ. We carry that name. He can't tell us from Jesus unless we don't know. Praise the Lord. So God himself, with his eternal purpose in mind, has put us in this fear. Praise the Lord. And because he has, the safest place that you can be is in that seat. Seated in the heavenly place. Amen. That, I believe, is the rest. Enter into my rest. Why? Jesus is no longer wrestling with the enemy. He's seated. The battle is over. He has won. And now he tells us, rest in my finished work. Sit down with me. And operate from your authority. Yes. Amen. When he told the Jews, he said, you know, enter into the promised land. Well, the promised land was supposed to be their rest. Houses they didn't build, vineyards they didn't plant, you know, fig trees they didn't grow, gardens that were all there. Everything was already there. They just had to go get it. But he tells us, the I think it's in Galatians where he gives us this kind of, or maybe it's Hebrews. Anyway, he gives us this analogy between that and this, and he says, they didn't enter in. They got freaked out by the giants, which they wouldn't even had to deal with if they had just entered in when they had the opportunity to enter in. But he said, lest you operate the way they did, be careful that you don't think the way they thought and fail to enter into my rest. If you fail to enter into his rest, you're just fighting a physical battle. They'll be just as big a giant to us as they were to them. The sickness, the poverty, the demonic forces, all the things that, you know, come against everybody. We have to enter into that rest. And the way that we do it, he's already told us twice. Sit down and rest in that finished work and operate from that authority, the authority that he has given us. I've received all power. All power and authority is given unto him. Go ye therefore. Because now you have the same power. You are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. I tell you, we talk these things, but we don't believe. You know, we don't live accordingly. It's not an attack. I'm just saying we need to think differently if we're going to get different results. Einstein, I think it was, or somebody said, you know, to continue to do the same thing, expecting a different result, is the definition of insanity. And the church has been doing it for nearly 2,000 years. Talk about crazy. No wonder people think we're nuts. You know, it's time that we begin to operate the way we really believe, to really live in accordance with God, amen, with his word, with his truth, amen. Outside, and here we use all sorts of other analogies, and of course, they're valid, but I'm just saying, to me, outside of the seat of Christ, we're in the flesh. Because that's what the devil was trying to get Jesus to do all the time he was fussing with him in the desert. Trying to get him from his position of knowledge and awareness of who he was and what authority he had. And that's what the devil still does. Get us off the seat. Get you off the throne. And the moment you're off of the throne, you lose your authority. You don't have authority anymore. You're just another human. You're in the flesh. Praise the Lord. So the enemy puts all of his effort into drawing us down from the spirit to the flesh. That's why grace is so imperative. Because the law is what the enemy has always used. Always. If there's no law, he has no weapons. Jesus stripped him of his weapons. What did he strip him of? The law, because now he fulfilled the law. There is no law. Now it's grace. If he can get you into a legal way of thinking or a religious way of thinking, he has taken you off the throne and brought you back into the flesh where now he has the control. But we've been given grace so that we have power over every principality and power in the heavenlies. Amen. We have been declared equal with Jesus Christ, seated with him in heavenly places. Amen. At the right hand of God, where all the power and authority exists. Praise the Lord. So, Ephesians chapter 2, and let's read verses 7 through 10. Ephesians 2, 7 through 10. That's why we have to believe. Believe is active. Believing is active. Believing is like a verb, but you have to, it has to be a continuous thing. You can't, I believe, and then, you know, I mean, that's what's happened. We thought, I believed, I'm saved, and forgot that without continuous believing, salvation is going to do you no good until you die. And that isn't why we're here. We were here to take dominion. We were here to take back the dominion that Adam gave up, that Jesus restored to us, and now we have to continue to keep it. Amen? So that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Jesus Christ. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Again, it's grace, 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 grace. It's God ordained them. God put them in us. God's going to do them. He's going to do them through us. But as Suzanne said, we live, but it's not us that live. It's Christ that liveth in us. It's him working through us. It's the power of God operating through us. Amen. Grace are you saved through faith. That not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Praise the Lord. Now, let's skip over to chapter 3, and we'll read verses 2 through 12. Still in Ephesians. Ephesians 3, 2 through 12. And this is all, still, Paul's hasn't changed the subject. I mean, he's still talking the same stuff. And remember, there's no chapters and verses. When it was written, it was continuous writing. So, if you have heard of the dispensation of grace of God, which is given me to you, word, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, which is the mystery of grace. Christ is this mystery. If you have heard, okay, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages wasn't made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, which is grace, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach. Now, we think of Paul as this great deal, but listen, Paul knows, he's a guy who knew the law inside and out. He knew the failure of man to keep the law. He knew it better than anybody because he knew the law better than anybody. So that's why he's saying the things that he's saying. Based on the law, I'm the biggest sinner there is. I am aware of it because I failed. He said, I didn't know covetousness until I read the law. All of a sudden then I realized, man, I'm coveting everything. It's the way the law works. So unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now, under the principalities and powers in heavenly places, all we've been talking about, might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Praise the Lord. So the mystery is what we're talking about tonight. We've got the power. We've got the authority. But we have to know it. We have to act on it. And that's what Paul's talking about. He's saying, I'm a nobody. I'm a nothing in terms of qualifications. But because of grace, God has given me a revelation of this mystery so that I can minister it to others, which is exactly what he's telling us. The only way he could do it is by the power of God, by grace, by understanding he had authority and dominion and power over all the heavenlies.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And he's trying to get us to understand we have the same thing. We've got the same ability, the same power. These guys are nothing but other human beings that have been awakened to Christ in them, to what this grace message is really all about. Amen? All right. In whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. All right? Let's go to Ephesians 6, and we'll read verses 14 through 17. In fact, let me go to Ephesians 6:12 first. Now, we read this about the armor all the time, but I want to put it into this context because that's what it's really about. We don't war against flesh and blood. This stuff, it's spiritual analogies is what the whole thing is about here. So, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places, whom we've already been told we have authority over, and they have to obey us. Amen. They know they have to, but we don't know they have to. And if we don't know they have to, they don't.
Right.
Even though they have to, if we know it and speak to it. If we operate from our seated place in the throne in Christ, they have no option.
Amen.
But if we don't know it, we're just wrestling with flesh and blood. We're wrestling with the latest sickness.
Yeah.
We're wrestling with the latest idiot.
Yeah.
You know, whatever. Amen? We're just struggling with humanity.
Yeah.
We're battling with the banker, the lawyer, you know, the Indian chief, whoever has some kind of authority. That's where we always end up being because we're not operating from where we're supposed to be. All right? All right, let's drop down, if you will, now, Mike, chapter 6, verse 14 through 17. You all know these scriptures, so it's not like we're talking about things you haven't already seen or heard. But stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So, first of all, we'll just deal with these quickly. The girdle of truth, or the girding your loins, right? Now, we know that that's everything else hooks to that in a Roman warfare, you know, their uniform, everything connects to that girdle, amen? And here's what this is saying. Understanding God's word holds everything else together. If you don't really understand grace, the other weapons are really not going to do you a whole lot of good. You can be disarmed in a hurry. Because all the devil's got to do is come and say, well, I heard what you just said.
Yeah.
I know what you thought, even if he doesn't know. He doesn't have to know. He just knows humans.
Right.
We do think. We say things. We do things. We think things. Even if we don't do them, he knows we're thinking them, and all he's got to do is then accuse us.
Yeah.
And immediately, everything starts falling apart. You lose your grip on the sword.
Yeah.
Amen. The helmet's all of a sudden like three sizes too big. Nothing's working. Nothing's functioning the way it's supposed to, right? So the core to everything is understanding the message of grace. Understanding you are who you are, not based on who you are, but based on who he is and who he has declared you to be. Amen?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. All right, two, the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness, acknowledging we are the righteousness of God in Christ. We don't need a bronze or brass breastplate. We don't need a bulletproof vest. We are the righteousness of God in Christ.
Yes.
That'll stop the fiery darts of the enemy.
Yes.
It'll stop them. Because if we know who we are, his weapons become nothing.
Right.
So we gotta know the message. We gotta know the truth.
Yes.
We gotta know that we are the righteousness of God. We're not becoming the righteousness of God. We're not someday gonna possibly make it to be the righteousness of God. We are now and forever the righteousness of God in Jesus, in Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Number three. Feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The gospel of peace is because it's the gospel of grace. Because it's grace, we can rest. We can be at peace with God. Therefore, if God is for us, who can be against us? It'll bring you peace even in turmoil, amen, because you can rest. That it is finished. That you are accepted. That you are the beloved. In whom he is well pleased.
Yes.
You have a power and authority because he has declared you righteous and holy as he is. Amen. The gospel of grace gives us peace.
Yes.
Amen. Number four, the shield of faith. Now, if you do any study of that, this shield was from head to toe. It covered their entire body. It wasn't like these little Lancelot things or Captain America. You know, it was it covered the entire body. They used to have what they called phalanx, and when they'd go into battle, they'd split into groups, and they would just come forward with those shields when they would fire arrows and try to use, you know, the arc of the arrow to come down on top of them. The one guy would put his up, the other guy would have his down. So they would essentially cover themselves front and top. So they were totally covered. They were protected, amen, from the enemy. When they would get into, serious battles where they were completely outnumbered, they would just encircle themselves like kind of like the wagon trains, you know, against the Indians. They would just get in a circle. They'd have and they were impenetrable.
Right.
These shields were just incredibly huge and complete cover. And so what he's telling us is the shield of faith keeps us safe and secure in Christ. We're protected from all of the attack of the enemy by the blood of Jesus. We're completely covered, completely protected, completely safe in Christ. Amen? All right, number five, the helmet of salvation. Now, I want you to go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 8, because this is kind of interesting here where they use this, the helmet of salvation, in two different ways. In 1 Thessalonians, it talks about hope. So it's the helmet of salvation. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 8. Let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith, love for a helmet, the hope of salvation. So the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Now remember, Abraham believed, he hoped against hope. In other words, he believed. That's the other way that they define that. He hoped against hope, and then the scripture says he believed God, and God declared him righteous. You think sometimes, well, I don't believe it. If you hope against hope, if you're hoping when it's hopeless, you're believing as far as God's concerned. That's living according to what he says and declares, even if it isn't manifested yet, even if it doesn't happen for 5 years, 9 years, 10 years, however long it was for Abraham. But not that that's the litmus test for how long it is for everybody, but I'm just saying sometimes it just doesn't happen like that because these battles are taking place and we're the ones fighting them. Don't kid yourself that there's some angel up there struggling on your behalf. They operate based on our words. And we are already there, spiritually speaking, in Christ. We are there. We have the authority. We release our authority, it seems like, from earth, because that's where we are physically. But spiritually, we're already there. It's an agreement. Amen? And let me remind you, wherever two or more agree, we're not schizophrenic, but we are flesh and spirit. And when we get our flesh, so this is the idea of renewing your mind, when we get our flesh to agree with the spirit, we believe.
Yes.
Even if the flesh resists, yes. Even if it's hoping against hope, God still declares it to be belief.
There you go.
Amen. You don't know how many times we have backed away from a battle that we had won. Because we listened to this instead of who we were.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So Abraham hoped against hope. And the salvation we're talking about here, it's not salvation for your soul. It's not your born-again experience. It's sozo. It's the word sozo. It's everything, nothing lacking, made whole, made whole. Amen? He quickened us together with Christ. We've never been whole. No, there is no whole human being out there unless they're born again. They're just a dead man walking. When you got born again, you became whole. You became one with God.
Yes.
Amen. Where you came from in the first place.
Yes.
You're brought back to that place. And if you look in the scriptures, it talks about in the end, all of this was about one thing. Us in Christ, Christ in God, everything coming back to its original source. Everybody. Not only being one with God, but knowing their oneness with God. Imagine this in heaven, walking around totally conscious, totally God thoughts. And we think, oh my God, that would be kind of creepy. You know, I mean, he's so good. Hey, God created us. He's very diverse. He's got a great sense of humor. He likes to party. I mean, look at the Israel. So it's not as bad as we think. He created sex, by the way. You know, I mean, so all of these things that I'm not trying to go down that road. I'm just saying, you know, we think, oh, my God, you know, that won't be. No. He's way ahead of us in the what's fun game. I mean, he knows. And we would walk in a place of constant awareness. No shame, no guilt, no fear, no innocent, perfect in Christ. Amen? So, That's the idea here, is that we hope against hope, that we know all things are made whole. We are complete in him, and there is nothing lacking. Poverty can't have a hold on us. Sickness and disease can't dominate us. Amen? Number six, the sword of the Spirit. Sword of the Spirit shows the word of God used, the truth activated, which is what we were talking about tonight. We awaken to the truth, we activate it.
Right.
When we know, others can know.
Right.
Once we are aware, others become aware simply because of us. People came to Jesus. You know, the church, here's what the church does. We run all over trying to get people.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't. He just went around and everybody came to him.
Exactly.
Now, we do it because we don't know who we are. We don't really understand how this thing works, and so we give it the Philistine expedient, you know, the human kind of way of trying to make something work. And I'm not against it. I'm just saying that isn't the purest way that God intends it. He intends us to be a revelation of Jesus Christ, and people are drawn to us. And here's the other thing about that. Mike and I were talking about this the other day. Here's the other thing. When Jesus went around, people were drawn to him. People came, and everyone that came to him was healed. Now, not everybody didn't get healed because not everybody came. But when they did come, they would ask him, and he would, in a kind, open way, explain. If they didn't want it, he just kept on walking.
Yes.
He didn't stay there and spend months and months begging and grieving and fretting over this one person that's not acting like they ought to act, and they're not coming along when I give them an opportunity. He just moved on.
Yes.
And in fact, he told his disciples the same thing. When you go out, he said, and if they don't want the message, wipe the dust off your feet and move on.
Yep.
Now, that doesn't mean he didn't care. We know that he cares, or he wouldn't have gone to him in the first place. But he also knows there are people that are receptive. And you can spend a lifetime trying to force somebody who just doesn't care. And if you just keep on keeping on, life will bring them. If they won't accept the goodness of God as a way of turning to God, life has a way of bringing you to God that's far less pleasant. Because sadly, most of us came that way. We didn't understand the goodness of God. And why didn't we? Because nobody really shared the goodness of God with us. They shared their religion with us. They shared their interpretation of God, who was angry probably at us because we weren't on their team. You know, we didn't play their reindeer games and all that kind of stuff. You know, we weren't doing what they were doing. And so, you know, you never knew who's the right one. But if you can point them to Jesus, if you can point them to a God who loves them in all of their chaos, in all of their screw-ups, in all of their failures, because we've come to know that to be the reality. I mean, think about it. If people really knew that, who would be against it? Who would say no? The problem is the mixed message, the mixture, the law and grace, the religion, and people are so confused, they think, you know, I'm gonna fail. I'll be in worse shape. The more I know, the more I'll be accountable for. I mean, you actually hear people talk that way. So don't, I want to, you know, ignorance is bliss. I don't want to know nothing. I just hope he has pity on me for being a fool, you know, for just being stupid. But if they knew the truth, it would set them free. Set them free from their own self-loathing. Well, maybe none of you ever had that, but praise the Lord. Most people out there, they don't like themselves very much. That's why they don't like anybody else. And they don't like themselves because they think God hates them. They know they do things that they shouldn't do. They know they're screwed up. But they think there's no hope. So they're either suicidal or they're just bad people to be around. Amen? So God wants to give us the word so that we activate it. Not just so we know it, but so that we can release it.
Exactly.
The word is in us.
Yes.
Amen? No. The word became flesh, dwelt among us, we beheld his glory, and now it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. We have the word. I've talked about this before. In fact, I mentioned it the other day. See, even, you know, you'd be talking to somebody, and you don't know the scripture. I mean, you don't know verbatim, you don't know chapter and verse, you know, it's Galatians 3:18. No, you don't know, but you'll say something that is in total agreement with that. The principle is already there, because he has put his word in us. Christ is in us, and by the Spirit we know, and so we say things, and it isn't, and sometimes it's probably good that we don't, because the person we're talking to, they don't know the Bible. And if you just start saying, well, the scripture, the Bible says, you know, John said this and somebody else said that, that don't mean anything to them. That's Joe Blow as far as they're concerned. And just because you know a chapter and a verse, it doesn't mean anything, because you could be quoting anything. They wouldn't know. But if you say something to them that touches them at their point of need, where they're hurting, it resonates. They go, whoa, that makes sense. I never thought of that before. And then you can say, that's the way God looks at this. That's how God feels about it. Amen? All right. Ephesians 6, and we'll stop with this. Ephesians 6, verse 18 and 19. And the good thing about this is we can just be us.
Yes.
We don't have to be weird. We don't have to be flaky. We don't have to be hyper spiritual. You know, I mean, we are. We just are. We don't have to act like we are. We just are. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. That's Paul talking.
Amen.
So, in essence, the result of awakening to our position of authority makes possible for us to release that authority and the power that's in us to other people, so that their eyes will be opened. so that the mystery is no longer a mystery to them either. We all love a mystery, but only when we get to the back page and we find out who done it. Amen? What it's really all about, right? And that's what Paul's saying. When we awake to the mystery that we have had revealed to us, it makes us possible to release the power and the authority through the principalities of the power in the air that are stopping this thing, that are veiling it, that are covering it up, that are hiding it and keeping it from people. It penetrates that so that other people then can be awakened to the same truth. And the mystery is no longer a mystery. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's victory over every attack of the enemy.
Yes.
It's we win,
yes,
and he loses.
Yes.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Amen. God bless you. So I just encourage you, and we need to be encouraged to do this. I got to do it myself.
You got to hope.